A very good morning to everyone. I'm Dr. Nithya from India. I'll be presenting about multimodal approach in the treatment of periorbital melanosis and darker skin. So, periorbital melanosis is a very common cosmetic problem in darker skin, and usually patients present with tired look, and there are multiple treatment options, which means none is perfect. The overall prevalence of periorbital melanosis in Indian women is about 50%, and according to Rano et al., commonest type of periorbital melanosis is vascular type, followed by constitutional type, post-inflammatory and shadow effects. And there's high incidence of periorbital melanosis, and there is PIH with periorbital melanosis mainly due to faulty pathophysiological response to cutaneous injury and its increased melanocyte activity. And PIH is a major limiting factor for treatment procedures like lasers and chemical peels. And prevention and management of PIH is very important in darker skin, and there's usually a longer recovery period after procedures. So coming to etiology, as you all know, the endogenous causes and exogenous causes. Endogenous being genetic, dermal melanocytosis, thin translucent lower eyelids, aging, facial structure deformities, and infraorbital swelling. Exogenous being excessive pigmentation, mainly due to post-inflammatory pigmentation due to atopic dermatitis, sun exposure, fatigue, smoking, lack of sleep, hormonal therapy, and other medical issues. Coming to classification, Huang et al. Classified periorbital melanosis into pigmented type, vascular type, structural, mixed type. Pigmented usually present with brown color discoloration around infraorbital folds, and vascular blue or purple color. Structural shadows formed by facial anatomic surface contours, lack skin and herniated fat. And mixed type usually combines two or three of the above appearances. How do you evaluate a case of dark circle? So usually a detailed history is very important. A family history, atopy, faulty habits, lifestyles, photosensitivity, and any other medical illness has to be ruled out. Stretch test can be done. If there is no change in pigmentation, it is mainly because of the dermal pigmentation, and if there is violaceous hue, it's because of subdermal vascularities. If the pigmentation improves, it's because of skin laxity. There are other diagnostic approaches like dermoscopy, Oud's lamp, photographic evaluation, polarized light and reflection spectrometry, and other baseline investigations should not be forgotten. CBC, vitamin B12, serum TCH are also very important to rule out other illnesses. Rano et al. Has graded periorbital melanosis into 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 types depending on the depth of pigmentation. Coming to treatment options, there are varied treatment options: topical depigmenting agents, chemical peels, laser therapies, microneedling, PRP, surgical options, and many others. But combination treatment should always be opted for to get optimal results. Hydroquinone is the most prescribed bleaching agent. 2 to 4% is the strength preferred for darker skin types. They're usually associated with side effects like skin irritation, post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation, exogenous ochronosis, leukomelanoderma, and coffee. And hydroquinone usually is not the preferred drug of choice for periorbital area. Kojic acid is available in strengths of 1 to 4%, and it's usually preferred in combination with other ingredients, and the usual side effects associated with it is erythema and contact dermatitis. Azelaic acid has been used for melasma mainly, and it has direct cytotoxic effects. It selectively affects abnormal melanocytes and reduces free radicals, can be used in post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. And azelaic acid in combination with other ingredients will give better lightening effect. But adverse effects associated with it include pruritus, erythema, and burning. Topical vitamin C is an antioxidant. It lightens hyperpigmented skin through inhibition of enzyme tyrosinase. It also has photoprotection effect and collagen remodeling. So it can be used for thickening the eyelid dermis and concealing the vascular type of periorbital melanosis. Topical retinoic acid. There is a study done by Momosova et al. Wherein 18 patients were included and 5% hydroquinone and 0.1% retinoic acid was used for 6 weeks, followed by application of Q-switched ruby laser. It resulted in patient satisfaction of about 83.3%. It lightens post-inflammatory hyperpigmented lesions and also stimulates new collagen. So, but it is purely tolerated in darker skin and it can also cause dermatitis. Coming to peels, alpha hydroxy acid peels. Most widely used alpha hydroxy acid peel is glycolic acid peel. Glycolic acid peel may contribute through various ways as an anti-inflammatory effect, keratolytic effect and antioxidant effect. And there's also been a study done by Murlis Chiarin wherein he used 15% glycolic acid peel, 2 series, 3 weekly interval with pre-peel treatment with 8% glycolic acid for 2 weeks. And he saw about 25 to 50% improvement on global physician, global assessment scale. But we can go up to 50%. I use normally 35% to 50% for periocular area. Coming to lactic acid peel, it's again an alpha hydroxy acid which has similar properties to that of glycolic acid, and it has one of the largest molecules that therefore there is slower penetration and less irritation. It also has hydrating effects, but it's not been extensively used. Coming to TCA peel, 15 to 18% is the preferred strength for periocular area. It has caustic effects and it causes precipitation of skin proteins leading to necrosis and therefore re-epithelialization and collagen remodeling. Pre-treatment with retinoin and hydroquinone can be done before doing TCA peel for better results. But usually the peel has to be extended to the entire face to avoid post-peel demarcation, and there are longer recovery periods associated with it, and good sun protection after peel is very important. It's contraindicated in patients in whom dark circles are caused by hypervascularity. Post-procedure, ice compresses, emollients, broad-spectrum sunscreens and maintenance creams are very important. Coming to PRP, PRP when injected to the under eye for dark circles, the bioactive substances which are released and it augments dermal elasticity by stimulating the removal of photo-damaged extracellular matrix components. It also synthesizes new collagen, but the only side effect associated with it is bruising or ecchymosis, and there may be mild burning sensation post-procedure. So there are non-ablative lasers and ablative lasers. Non-ablative lasers being IPL, Q-switched ruby or Q-switched NDAG lasers. The main problem associated with these lasers in darker skin is post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. So to keep that in mind. Otherwise, the overall global improvement should be rated as excellent or good. Ablative lasers like CO2 lasers and erbium-YAG lasers. There is thermal injury here and it can stimulate collagen, lighten pigment and tighten the skin. But again, depends on the operator's skill. The side effects associated with it, like hypo and hyperpigmentation, obvious demarcation, ectropion and etc. There's other surgical modalities like blepharoplasty, autologous fat graft, which usually is done for loss of periorbital volume. There are advantages and disadvantages associated with each and every treatment. So careful patient selection and optimizing or customizing the treatment to depending on the skin type of patient and depending on the type of periocular pigmentation is very important. There are several studies about combination of treatments, as you can see. There are a lot more, but how do you choose? So again, it depends on customizing the treatment options and also the operator's skill and also the skin type and type of periocular pigmentation. So these are a few of my cases. As you can see, she's a lady who's in late 30s. She presented with pigmentation as well as vascular type dark circle, and I did 3 sessions of glycolic peel and 1 session of CO2 laser. You can see the difference in the pigmentation and also reduction in fine lines. There's another patient who presented to me with post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation due to constant rubbing of the eyes. I did 4 to 5 sessions of glycolic with lactic acid peel and 3 sessions of monopolar radio frequency. You can see the changes in the pigmentation as well as slight reduction in the fine wrinkles around the eyes. There's another patient of mine who presented with pigmentation, periocular rhytides and lax skin. I did 2 sessions of TCA with yellow peel and 1 session of CO2 laser with PRP and 1 session of Q-switch laser. He's still under treatment with me. You can see the difference in the pigmentation as well as improvement in the laxity of the skin as well as the periocular rhytides. So another patient of mine with excessive pigmentation. I did 5 to 6 sessions of glycolic acid peel with lactic acid peel and 1 session of CO2 laser and 1 session of Q-switch laser. You can see the reduction in the pigmentation in the last picture and along with improvement in the texture of the skin. Another patient of mine who presented with a pigmented type of dark circle, and I did 4 to 5 sessions of peel and lactic acid peel and 3 sessions of radio frequency. You can see the improvement in overall texture of the skin as I included the entire face while doing the treatment. So in conclusion, there are multifactorial etiology, multiple treatment options, and there are multimodal approaches for the treatment of dark circles, which again depends on physician skill. Thank you.